Hello there, everyone. In this session, we're going to talk about an operational expense burden that I'm quite sure, like me, some of you have been living with for perhaps 3 decades. Specifically, I'm talking about the operational expense of managing loads of servers. My name is Dean Wells. I'm a program manager in the Azure Compute team, and I'm going to walk you through a product that's been in the making for the past 2 years or so. Customers have been telling us for years, and I was one of those customers as of about 12 years ago, that IT management is complex. I completely agree, it is indeed. So some of the things that they specifically point to are the reduction of OPEX costs, that's operational expense. It's hard to maintain their operational security, so they'd like to improve that, make it easier. They'd like to be able to optimize operations with reliable automation. And again, they would like to use the cloud for this, but keeping pace with cloud innovation is a problem in and of itself. We also decided to have a chat with the developers. We learned from them that most have a laptop and a DevBox. The DevBox is usually a high horsepower server, and unfortunately, they spend a decent chunk of their time managing operating systems. That is not desirable. And then from the IT folks all the way up the IT management chain, we heard the feedback that anything that can simplify or reduce that human operational expense burden of managing operating systems is a differentiator for them. If we get into some of the details, customers told us there was no motivation to refactor their LOB workloads. Many assumed you had to do that, or you're just moving it to run it somewhere else. And they said that provided little more than just a different place to run the VM. There was no OPEX improvement. And again, they cited this same fact we referenced earlier on, that the pace of change in the cloud makes it hard for them to maintain lockstep with the updates to the services or new services. So the lessons that we learned from this are, there are line of business apps still out there, millions of them, running on classical computing architecture. And by that, I mean it's a VM or a bare metal box. It's got an operating system on it. It's got a workload on top of that. And it may be part of some cluster or some N-tier application. This is still a pervasive way of running computing technology on premises as well as in the cloud. They told us that these line of business apps aren't going to go anywhere quickly. So from that, I can infer there's a long tail. Microsoft is actually a fantastic example of this. We have over 5,000 line of business applications, some of which quite literally looked like they were written in 1988. And I'm sure the developer of that application is now blaming me for ridiculing his app, but hey, there we go. Last but not least, what could we do in Azure to simplify this? What can we do to add value to these classical computing scenarios that you can't already get on premises today? So we came back and we asked ourselves, what's missing? We looked at the two ends of our service stack in Azure, where we've got IaaS, infrastructure as a service, at the bottom end of it, where you literally rent virtual machine compute hardware from us in a virtualized solution. And at the top end of that stack, we've obviously got our PaaS solutions, where you can pull on cloud APIs to make development far, far easier and implement things with elastic scale, all of those good things. And then there's the software as a service front. The canonical example customers give us is when we replaced their Microsoft Exchange clusters with what at the time was Exchange Online and Office 365 and is now coined as Microsoft 365, that was the panacea of cloud computing's value to them. Can we do anything like that for infrastructure as a service VMs where they're still running in this classical compute mode? Well, we figured we could. We initially sort of toyed with the idea and we called it operating system as a service, and you can see it sits nicely on the pyramid there in between IaaS and PaaS and SaaS. The goal of this would be to replace repetitive day-to-day ops tasks with something I referred to as an exception-only management model. What this really means is rather than you doing the same human labor, repetitive task on a daily and or a weekly basis, the only time that you'll hear from us, a service that's picking up that slack for you, is when an exception occurs that we can't handle. In every other case, if it's a healthy, steady state, the operating system management burden becomes a hands-free thing of the past because we're doing that work for you. This is what we like to refer to as Automanage. So the first of our features is going to be around Azure best practices for virtual machines. That basically means we intelligently onboard your virtual machines to a select curated set of services according to whether they are dev test or production virtual machines. Today, we're doing something along the lines of 11 services, and by the time we reach general availability, that will be up in the 21 or 22, I think, at last count. So key takeaways, what exactly does Azure Automanage virtual machine best practices do for you? So first up, We intelligently onboard you to select best practices Azure services. We configure each of those services per that product group's own set of best practices. We also configure the guest operating system per the baseline configuration that Microsoft has been doling out now for years with Windows, and that baseline config changes with each different version of Windows Server that's released. We automatically detect for drift, i.e. if somebody changes the Azure backup configuration and it falls outside the scope of our definition of best practices, then we are going to drag it nicely, or kicking and screaming if it prefers, straight back into conformance with the best practices definition for that service. And we do this for the VM's entire lifecycle. Last but not least, the onboarding experience is point, click, set, forget in the portal. And we obviously also support Azure policy for at-scale scenarios. By the time that we're at general availability, we will also support things like Python, Go, Cloud Shell, PowerShell commandlets with their own modules specific to Automanage, all of those good things. So if we take a look at VM best practices today, it does actually exist. So Azure Automanage's VM best practices feature is not something entirely new. It is entirely new in that it's done in code. The way it existed on Azure in the past, and still does today, is in the form of a best practices white paper that lives in the Cloud Adoption Framework. If you wanted to implement Azure Virtual Machine best practices today, you would simply browse to the white paper in the Cloud Adoption Framework. It's prescriptive guidance, but it's lengthy. It can take anything upwards of 6 hours to complete every single one of those tasks manually. So obviously, building automation around that would be fantastically valuable. In addition, the white paper is a one-off set of steps. If it drifts from that configuration because somebody changed it after the fact, the white paper isn't going to jump in and put it back for you. Automanage Virtual Machine best practices obviously will. So I think rather than continue to talk about this, what I'd like to do is give you a demonstration where I'll walk you through a couple of the portal onboarding experiences. I'll talk to you about the differences between dev test and production environment VMs, because you get to tell us which one it is, and we will choose that curated set of services according to that particular role in life. For example, a dev test machine, that may be a short-lived VM. It may only live for a day or two. You wouldn't really want it onboarded to Azure Backup, incurring fees from storage of backups in the backup vault. That's the kind of stuff there. And then last but not least, I'll walk you through exactly what our preferences model allows you to control about the entire onboarding experience and the things that we would remediate over time. So let's jump into a demo. Here I am in the Azure portal. All I'm going to do is type in AutoM and it will bring up Automanaged Azure Machine Best Practices. This takes me to the main landing page for Automanage. You can see here that I've got 6 machines, 5 of which are already auto-managed, 1 of which is in a pending state. I'm able to click on the pending state and figure out why it's not yet completed. And in this particular case, it says the machine was auto-managed whilst it was turned off. Subsequently, we're waiting for you guys to turn it back on and we'll then complete the auto-managed process and onboard it to all of the services that make sense for that particular machine. You'll also notice here that we support both Windows and Linux. We don't really care which version of Windows Server it is that you're running. For Linux, we support the most popular distros and versions. So let's go ahead and onboard a new virtual machine to Azure Machine Best Practices. We'll do a couple of them in one go. So the first thing I need to do is click on Enable on existing VM. And then this brings me into the page where I get to choose which virtual machines, what the configuration is, etc. So let's start with the machines I'd like to onboard. You'll notice here we've got the standard Azure filtering capabilities in place. You'll also notice that the machines here are listed as eligible, and I can also check a box that says show me the ineligible virtual machines. This is us assessing all virtual machines over which you have administrative control and making a pre-assessment as to whether they're eligible or otherwise. This machine here, this particular Linux one, is ineligible, as you can see, because it's currently running in a region that we don't support. That's simply because we're only in public preview. By the time we hit general availability, of course, all regions will be supported. So I'll go ahead and decheck that, show me only the eligible ones, at which point I'll choose one Windows and one Linux, and I'll click on select. Next, I need to tell Automanage whether the machine is dev test or prod. The reason for this is if we take a look at the comparison between those two choices, here's production. You'll notice here that it onboards to all these services, and that list will grow somewhere around 20 by the time we hit general availability. But if I take a look at backup, you'll notice that for the production environment, I do onboard machines to backup.
If, however, I change the environment to dev test, you'll notice that backup disappears from the list. This is because backing up virtual machines incurs a fee to store the backup data in the backup vault. A dev test machine may only be alive for 3 hours. There's really no reason to back it up. Hence, for dev test profiles, we optimize for that workload and potentially for that very short lifetime. So we'll go ahead and say prod. What I'm then going to do is specify my configuration preferences. If you leave it as the default, then that is indeed Azure Best Practices, and we will onboard those VMs per a white paper named Azure Best Practices for Virtual Machines that exists in the Azure Cloud Adoption Framework. If, however, you've got a couple of things you'd like to change, you can click on Create New Preferences, at which point you give it a name, and I'll call it Dean11 because I'm a genius. I'll say it's in that subscription. I'll select my standard resource group. I'll say it's in the East US region. And right now we support customizations for backup and for Azure IaaS anti-malware. In the case of backup, for example, I can specify the frequency, the time zone, all of those good things. In the case of Azure IaaS anti-malware, I can configure these basic details in the same way as you would if you were onboarding manually. In addition, though, I can switch it off. The reason for this is we found that many customers work with third-party anti-malware technologies and they're happy with that particular product, in which case we've allowed you to switch off the use of Azure IaaS anti-malware so that it doesn't block you from using Automanage for the rest of the valuable services that we onboard you to. So at this point, I would simply go ahead and click Create, and I would click Enable. That will return me back to the grid view. Within a couple of minutes, those virtual machines will be onboarded to Automanaged. In addition, I can also create Automanaged virtual machines from scratch. So here we are on an operating systems preview page that I happen to have up. I'll click on Create. This will take us to precisely the same Azure VM create flow as you're used to. I'm going to give my virtual machine a name of Dino11, I think I used for the preference, so we'll use that same number here. I'll also select the Windows Server Azure Edition. This is a Generation 2 VM. Click on Management, and what you'll notice here is I have the ability to have Automanage turned on from day one. For Windows Server Azure Edition, it will automatically default to a production Automanaged VM, such that when the machine is created, it will automatically be onboarded to all of those best practices services and configured and auto-managed from that point forward across its entire lifecycle. To reiterate, again, if it drifts from that configuration, we will drag it back in using our remediation technology to make sure that it is continually configured to our specification that adheres to Azure best practices. I can also do this as well. If I come back to here and I select this one here, for example, let's go with Ubuntu, and I then come back to management, you'll notice that we don't automatically enable Automanage for every OS release. For the moment, that's only for Windows Server Azure Edition. You'll also notice, because Automanaged is disabled, the controls you're used to having over which services you onboard to after the creation process, just that one-time onboarding exercise, they're still enabled for you. If, however, I come back up here and I select production, because Automanage onboards you to Azure Backup and monitors that across the entire lifecycle of your virtual machine, we no longer allow you to switch backup off. That wouldn't make any sense because the moment the machine was born, we would automatically fix it and onboard it to Azure Backup anyway. So no reason to present that option. Last but not least, obviously I'm showing you the portal onboarding experience here for both new VMs and for existing VMs. By the time we release the product into general availability, we will support additional onboarding technologies such as Python, Go, direct submission of ARM templates, Azure Policy, PowerShell, all of those good things.
So hopefully that was helpful. Let's go through and show you specifically which operating systems we support. Obviously, we support Windows Server 2012, 2012 R2, 2016, 2019, and the stuff that comes thereafter. And on the Linux front, we support what we consider to be the dominant distros running in Azure today, which basically span SLES, CentOS, RHEL, and Ubuntu, and the versions are listed there in the little speech bubbles for you. Let me show you a couple of the differences that are currently in play today. We're still in public preview at this point, so hopefully we'll iron out these differences as we get closer to general availability. I certainly don't want to go through this entire table with you because I think that might well bore you senseless, but consider this as a table that you could go and take a look at after the fact, because I think this would be valuable for you to understand exactly what we do for each of the environments, dev, test, and production, and the differences for each of those environments between Windows and Linux. So a few quotes just to throw out at you from the last Ignite session where we delivered this, and it was basically the announcement for Automanage best practices. We've obviously made some substantial progress since then, but even without Linux support, we still received a plethora of very, very positive feedback. My personal favorite here is Automanage is the bomb. I couldn't agree more. And then obviously Automanage is on fire, fire, fire. That made me laugh, so therefore that's also high on my list. This is a great summary of the kind of feedback we've been receiving. We've got a large number of customers already onboarded trying Automanage out in its public preview release. We're still in public preview today, and if you'd like to come and give it a shot, I've got some links here for you on screen to get you started, as well as some deep dive links that will take you into how do you onboard at scale using Azure Policy, for example. What things can you affect? What things can you configure using the Azure portal, etc. So that's everything that I have for you today. I hope you're as excited about the product as I am. Thank you very much for listening.